question.
Scott McGrew with NBC. Is there a specific kilowatt hour cost if I want to install this in my factory? What is my specific cost?
For our customers today, it's somewhere between the 9 to 10 cents a kilowatt hour. And most of our customers today that you heard in California pay between 13 and 14 cents a kilowatt hour to PG&E. So they save between 4 and 5 cents for every kilowatt hour of electricity they generate from our box. All costs included.
My friend here, Carrie.
Carrie Dolan from Forbes, just to follow up on that. So that 9 to 10 cents a kilowatt.
Sorry, Carrie Dolan from Forbes. That 9 to 10 cents a kilowatt hour, that includes net of the 20% break you get if you buy these in California and the 30% federal tax.
Exactly. Break. That's inclusive of all the costs and all the subsidies together.
And just a quick one, do you have any of these installed outside of California?
Not right now. It's a huge market for us, and it's in our backyard.
In the center here.
Hi, I'm Phil Keyes with Nikkei Electronics. As you mentioned, fuel cells have been worked on for quite a few years. Can you give us a bit of key details about what you see as the technology innovations that have brought you where you are now?
You know, one of our co-founders built the first Gemini fuel cell in the early 60s. So we've known for more than 50 years between us co-founders and put fuel cells on submarines, space stations, and everything in between, and space probe. We started the company to make it affordable. So it's not, fuel cells have never been an issue of, will they work? They have been an issue of, can you make a commercially viable product, an economically viable product that's reliable and can offer the customer that? So there is hundreds of innovations that went into making that cost effective and reliable. There is no one secret magic bullet that made that happen.
One comment I'd like to make is that not all fuel cells are the same. Can you turn up my volume a little? Okay. The fuel cells all of you know about are the PEM or permeable electronic membrane cells. These are different. They're solid oxide fuel cells. They're made from ceramic. And they're a completely different animal. And as far as I know, it's the first time they've ever been commercialized. So you do have to make a distinction what kind of fuel cell we're talking about.
In the back.
Can you wait for the mic?
Obviously, this has huge implications for purveyors of the grid and utilities. What kinds of discussions have you had with them in possibly partnering or allowing your technology to be used in a hybrid way? Because we're not just going to cut down the line, so.
Well, we are actually a friend of the utility. Like John said on 60 Minutes, the utilities don't build nuclear power plants. They don't make gas turbines. They buy them from other companies and they use them to produce electricity and supply it to the customer. So if the utility is in the business of supplying a customer with electricity, servicing them, and collecting a fee for it, there's no reason why they wouldn't be able to do that with the Bloom Energy servers. And in addition to that, every utility in the country is now required, mandated, to have an RPS standard where they have to transform a certain percentage of their generation to clean generation. And a 24/7 reliable, clean generator that can meet the RPS standard is very attractive to the utilities. So they are talking to us, and we are in discussions with them.
Front row here, Greenwire.
I was just hoping that you could explain again how the solar works, how it would run on solar.
So the question was, how does your Bloom Energy server work with the solar panel, and what needs to happen? What happens there is, during the day when the sun shines, the solar panel produces enough electricity to power the home, but it also the solar panel produces more energy, more electricity, that goes into the home energy server, the Bloom Energy server, converts water into hydrogen and stores that locally. So the excess electricity is stored as a fuel, locally, low pressure, no hydrogen infrastructure. During the night when the sun is not shining, the hydrogen goes in as a fuel, and the system produces electricity for the home. In addition, whether your car is a hydrogen-burning car or an electron-consuming electric car, the home energy server becomes the gas station. This is the model. For market reasons, cost reasons, multiple other reasons, the automotive fleet changing to where it needs to go, solar coming to the price point it needs to come to, we're about a decade away from this product. We're about a decade away from this product, okay? But what we have done is demonstrated every aspect of this technology end to end and patented this technology worldwide.
If I can add, there's a wonderful description of this energy future in one of my favorite books, Tom Friedman's Hot, Flat, and Crowded. So look there, and I think you'll enjoy.
In the back.
You know, when we talk to our customers, what they say is, as long as you can give us an electricity-only box, that would be our preference because that is the most fungible energy form. You can make heat, you can have a light bulb, you can power your computers, whatever you need to. If you build a box that provides both heat and electricity, the amount of heat you use varies depending on night and day, seasons, geography, where you are. So every location that you put a box becomes a custom installation. Those are the things that add to cost, make these things less attractive. We figured out a way of taking all the heat we generate and very cleverly use it back in our system to provide the highest possible electrical output one can get. And our customers love that. We are meeting the demand of our customer. The product is designed to give what the customer is looking for.
Right here, Black.
Mark Fulmer of the Auto Channel. I'm envisioning two boom boxes in my electric vehicle. One is producing the electricity, certainly around the other is creating a fuel form. Is my vision possible? And what are the automotive applications?
So we think neither one is in your car. It's a single unit. It's outside your car. You don't want to be hauling a power plant everywhere you go. You don't want to be hauling a gas chemical plant everywhere you go. That's wasted energy. You want to put that where it belongs, stationary, on the ground. And you want to make your car carry only the things that it needs to carry, you and your cargo. It should not be inside the vehicle is what we would say from a system to system efficiency perspective.
And one further question. If you take the traditional hydrogen fuel system, certain amount of hydrogen, certain amount of oxygen, both. Okay, now you take the balloon energy, how is that ratio different? Do you use more fuel, more oxygen?
Very good question, and the very simple way to answer that is just think of calories. 100 calories coming in, whether it's 100 hydrogen calories or 100 natural gas calories, it doesn't matter. We can take hydrogen, we can take natural gas, anything. For those 100 calories coming in, we can produce the maximum calories out of electrons compared to any other technology that's out there. Absolutely, from a calorific value.
In the center here.
I'm a proud caller from the Mercury Duke, and I'm hoping to do a graphic on how it works. I've heard you talk a lot about that. I don't know if there's a diagram on here, or like a scientific.
Yes, there is a diagram, and there's an animation. You will be able to get that. And yeah, go ahead.
In a permeable electron membrane cell, a proton, hydrogen proton, goes through the cell, and the electron has to go through the circuit to come back and recombine. In this fuel cell, an oxygen ion goes through a ceramic membrane. It's actually a hard material. And it is the movement of oxygen through the cell from the air that is what separates electrons and the atoms and creates the power. So it's a completely different technology. And it's much more robust, and it doesn't require extremely expensive catalyst palladium and platinum required in prior fuel cells. If you wanted to ask why they haven't taken over the world, palladium, platinum, and membranes that wear out is the reason the old style fuel cell haven't taken over the world. This is brand new and different. I was going to actually write an equation.
Simple way, sand versus platinum. That's a simple way.
No, but it's simply described to this.
The process is air comes up against the fuel cell. It's been heated by the exhaust. That's the reuse of heat he talked about. And the air, the oxygen in the air, goes through the fuel cell and combines with, let's say, natural gas on the other side. The air leaves behind electrons, and they have to go through a circuit to come back and get back home again. And that's where the power comes from. Conventional technology, the species flowing through the cell is proton, from hydrogen ion, hydrogen atom, as opposed to oxygen. A totally different way of doing business.
I hope so.
In the back corner here. John Blackstone from CBS News. Just want to cost competitive with the grid right now is a 50% subsidy. And if that's correct, how long until you're able to stand on your own without 50% subsidy, and how long do you expect your subsidies to last?
Well, our philosophy to subsidy is very simple. It needs to be like a feeding bottle. It's a new technology. You need to get that subsidy in the early days. Very quickly, we want to get out of the subsidy. Otherwise, we're not going to those developing world economies that we talked about that we need to make an impact. So we're very passionate about getting there. Now, in terms of the subsidies, I want to make one point clear. Don't assume that your traditional grid electricity that you're getting is not subsidized. Every oil tanker and every oil power plant that produces electricity for you, the Navy ships has got them using your taxpayer dollars. That's called subsidy. Every large coal mine that happens and the rights to that, the large electric poles and wires, that's called the grid, that was put during the rural electrification project, they were all subsidies. So the conventional power you're getting from the grid today is not market priced power, it is subsidized power. It is unreasonable to ask for a new technology to come in and compete against the incumbent subsidized market. That's number two. The third thing is, there are plenty of countries in the world that provide very large subsidies for this new technology because they all realize the one that wins in this game is going to be an economic leader. So it better be our country because we need those jobs, we need that economic growth. That's the three-part answer. And John, you want to add to that?
May I return to Akio's question? I was a little flip. I apologize. 15 years ago, no internet. None. No web browser. Today, internet. $1 trillion economy. 1.2 billion users. What's the energy economy? We got 4 billion people on the planet who use electricity. It's a $6 trillion piece of the economy. Energy is just in the U.S. I'm not talking about all the rest of the world. So energy is much bigger than internet. I believe that Bloom and a number of other innovations, but Bloom, first and foremost, is just going to make an impact on that.
Thank you.
So I run a chip company, and we all think of Silicon Valley and Silicon and the $350 billion chip market. One of the reasons I got interested in Bloom, other than their technology, which is pretty exciting, is that some of the utility bills in the U.S. is $1 trillion with a T. So it dwarfs the semiconductor industry. You want to talk about economic opportunity, it's huge.
I'd like to come back to your question also. A lot of people have asked about cost and how fast cost is being reduced here. When we invested and I joined the board in 2004, cost was more than 25 times what it is today. Just extrapolate a little bit, and I think you'll you'll see that this technology will not need subsidies in the near future.
Question here in the front.
You had, David Baker with San Francisco. You had mentioned earlier what the going to in California right now, if the utility does go out and buy a bunch of these and just sticks and make the price of their substations, would that qualify for this? Or would it matter, would it be a matter of whether they're using it?
It would qualify, you know, definitely because of the very high efficiency and the total reduction in carbon that we have. The thing that they will do, though, is they will put it very close to the points of congestion on the transmission grid and not stick it right next to their power plant. Because understand that in addition to meeting a regulatory issue, the utilities have problems of running the grid to fail in congested areas in cities, whether it's San Francisco or Los Angeles or any of these places. So by putting these boxes right inside the city, they're allowing for the grid to not get congested, and so it's a double win for them.
Not just that, but the conventional approach to RPS standards is large power, you know, solar plants in the desert. And then you have to build transmission and distribution to get it from the desert to the people who consume it. Having a modular, small, renewable solution that you can deploy close to the consumer saves a lot of money for the utilities in the process.
But if it uses that gas,
well, if it runs on a renewable fuel, like a biogas.
It would only qualify under the RPS.
That's correct, on a renewable fuel.
Yeah.
Question over here?
I wish.
I wish. That would be good. I'll take that. So what we have said is the following. The units cost between $700,000 and $800,000. Using those units, our customers are able to produce electricity from 9 to 10 cents a kilowatt hour. That translates to them to a 3 to 5 year payback. That's all the economics that we need to discuss. The rest is between us and the customer, and you should be able to understand the rest of it. Yeah, in terms of the funding, we have said it's somewhere in the $400 million ballpark, and I think that's good enough for what needs to be. It is from a variety of it's from a variety of investors. Kleiner was the first investor in the company, and NEA was the second investor. They both.
Question right here.
Yes. Well, the subsidies exist for a while, and before the subsidies run out, we will not need the subsidy. So that's a hypothetical question we don't need to answer.
Question right here.
I'm just curious about whether currently one is the others, and related to that, whether which fuel input for your current customers.
Natural gas is the natural fuel of choice right now, because in every building, in every big building out here, there's a pipeline that comes in. Most of our customers want to use biogas and directed biogas, but the availability of that is slowly picking up. As soon as it starts picking up, what we understand from our customers is they want to switch very quickly. And the beauty is, they don't have to worry about, do I need to wait for that? Because the same box that they purchased today can, with no modification, you don't need to tell the device that you have switched. The device is smart enough to know that you have switched to fuel, and it'll take care of itself. So when they buy this unit, they don't have to worry about what the next fuel is.
What have we got to over here?
Yeah. Hi, Mark Hockman, PC Magazine. I think you mentioned a 10-year warranty, and you also mentioned other things. It's just as possible. I was wondering, within that 10-year span, do you imagine that all the existing original discs would survive that 10 years, or would you need to hot swap out?
That's something that we keep internal to us. We have to make the economics work, and we are very confident that we can make the economics work. So we have a maintenance price and that's not something we discuss.
Let's go from the very back corner there.
We've been called that before.
We just ordered 8 of their boxes, Energy Servers, excuse me. And what you need to do is hook up a natural gas line to the box, and you're done. So you pour a concrete slab, the box comes in at 8 in the morning, they leave by noon, and you hook up natural gas, and that's it. There's not a separation in the market between biogas and normal natural gas. So what you need to do is have a contract. So somewhere in the center of the state, where somebody's composting cow manure, for example, and capturing the natural gas from that, you buy gas from them, they put it into the gas system, you pull gas out of the gas system, and you have to guarantee that the amount of gas you use, you put in biogas on the other end, but you use the natural gas system, there's only one infrastructure.
Stay tuned.
In the very back there.
Majority of our jobs are right here in this valley around the Sunnyvale area. Majority of our jobs are right here right now.
In the back corner.
We have plenty of customers and customer demand, but again, stay tuned. We will announce as we go. Very good question. We have designed our systems for cradle to cradle and not cradle to grave. A vast majority of everything that we do is recyclable from the sand that can be ground back up and reused to the metal that can be reused. So we're very conscious of that. A lot of our processing in the last 8 years, working with our vendors, we have switched from chemical-based processing to aqueous-based processing. So it's very environmentally friendly. We're a very conscious environmental company, and we are doing a cradle-to-cradle thought process on this as opposed to a cradle-to-grave.
In the back?
Yeah, Michael Gales from Green Tech Media. I'm interested in the reverse reaction. Can you do that on the existing fuel cells? It's the kind of thing that can come out in future products, and then you can possibly shed some light on the map.
We can do that with our existing fuel cell technology, but our current system is not made to run it in reverse. You know, the plumbing, the piping, you know, everything else that you need, the controls, the guts. We have proven that entirely before, to the satisfaction with data points to get patents on this, and to be able to defend those patents. But the current technology is capable of doing that. But we don't believe that it's the right time for it to enter the market. We would simply go with water, produce hydrogen, and be able to recycle it. That's a lot simpler thing to do in a home than try to take CO2 from somewhere.
In the very back.
Mark Crowley from the Auto Channel.
Yeah, you wouldn't want to put our unit in the car. The low temperature fuel cells are wonderful because you turn the ignition on and you're ready to go. It operates at low temperature. That's what you expect from a car. We are stationary power generation. The way Honda would use us is if they have a plug-in hybrid, or they have a all-electric car, or they have a hydrogen-burning combustion engine. There's nothing wrong with the combustion engine. It's a beautiful piece of technology. It's the most inexpensive transmission that we ever have known. So as long as you can put hydrogen in there, and all that's coming out of your exhaust is water, it is as clean as anything you have, and it's the most inexpensive way to do it. So why is everybody not doing it? Because the ability to put a hydrogen infrastructure all around the country is very expensive. There are safety issues, other things. Because now we have brought the gas station to the home, to the office, you don't need that hydrogen infrastructure. It's distributed. We can produce hydrogen from our device. So there are three ways they can use it. The last way, which you suggested, is to take our box and put it in their car. We don't recommend that.
In the corner, in the back there.
Once you have chosen a fuel source and you're working with that, if you decide to move to another fuel source, does any tweaking have to be done to the box? It's just a switch.
You can switch on the fly. You can switch on the fly on a single day. Our machine has the smarts to figure out what's coming in and adjust to that.
And then just a quick follow-up. What's the revenue ramp for the business? What are you looking at as far as the number of customers today? Are you sure how many customers today? Do you have plans for 100, 1,000, 10,000? Where is this going to go over the next, say, year, 10, 18 months as far as revenue?
Well, again, this is not software that once you have perfected, you can stamp out 1 million CDs or 2 million CDs and ship it out. We have to grow. It's a ramp. It's manufacturing. It's similar to building a car factory. It takes time. Okay? And if you grow too fast, you have to worry about quality. We will not, as a company, compromise quality as we grow. So we have a sense of urgency. But we will balance that against building a quality product. The demand is always going to be far greater than our supply for the foreseeable future. That's our expectation. John, you want to add to that?
No, I just want to, questions for General Powell on the global view of this or energy security for our country.
You want to speak? Yeah. Back there.
What temperature do these boxes?
Yes, it's 800 degrees Celsius, which is about three times cooler than the hottest part of the inside of your car, and it's about two times cooler than how your home heating furnace, the hottest part of your home heating furnace. Just as you don't think about those as hot devices, when you go and tour our box, you'll see that you will not think about it as a hot device. You can put your hand anywhere you want, just somewhere inside. It's something at 800, but 800 is not a hot temperature. We're all used to very hot things that we use on a daily basis.
We have time for one more question. I'll take it from the corner.
General Powell, with your connections with the military, are you talking to the military about using this technology?
No, not directly, but I have talked to friends of mine who are in touch with the military folks. And putting it behind the command post and doing a propane tank, sometimes you have a fuel and you're
Thank you very much.
Thanks for watching The Auto Channel. For more great automotive information and entertainment, visit theautochannel.com, the Internet's most complete and comprehensive automotive information resource.